We're live. Hi, everybody. Welcome to Beyond the Bay Live. Thank you. I'm Larry Dominey. I'm a board member of your Bay Community Theater. But tonight, I'm host, moderator, and referee. This is the first time we've done this, going live or using a streaming like this. I would like to thank everybody for showing up tonight on behalf of our Bay Community Theater and to all the programming team members that put this together. The last week, this is all new with all the technology, discovering the technology, how it works, and how it works, basically, and how we can operate it. So as we bumble along today and we do different things, click the wrong buttons, play the wrong sounds or something, please bear with us. We will get better as we go, time goes on. This event is being streamed using free streaming software from StreamYard. From StreamYard. It's turned around backwards here. From StreamYard. So it's being powered by StreamYard and then broadcast to YouTube. Both Google and StreamYard are providing this and for free. And as a nonprofit, this helps us a lot to be able to still communicate and interact with our community. So thank you very much to those two people, those organizations. Tonight is a question and answer session, just like we would do in the theater, but today it's going to be live. It's similar to the theater, what we're doing, but we have two panelists today. They're going to be with us. Let me introduce those. The first is going to be Kevin Maher. And Kevin is an industry insider. He has over 20 years of experience with various studios, including 20th Century Fox and Warner Brothers. He received a master's degree in film studies from Wayne State University and writes the classic movie blog top10filmlist.com. Kevin is an active volunteer, original member of the Bay Community Theater's programming team, and currently lives with his wife and children in suburban Detroit. And he wants to let everybody know that his family has property up at Northport, so that's how he's connected up here to Leland Law County. So thank you very much for helping us out today. Thank you.
You bet. Thanks.
Next is Ted Kroll. Ted Kroll is a film historian. Ted was born in Washington, D.C., a rare native. You rarely meet anybody that's actually born in D.C. Started as an usher at the local repertory theater in D.C. Ted went on to teach a film course and courses at Trinity College in Hartford, and was helpful in helped establish a movie theater that is still operating to this day. Over the years, he has maintained his devotion to cinema by collecting over 3,000 films, the entire history of cinema, in his closet. Ted moved up 7 years ago. He's an original member of the programming committee at the Bay Theater, and he is pleased and honored to have the opportunity to share his experience in the online Beyond the Bay series. So thank you, Ted, for doing all this and coming to be part of this. And I just want to say that with the both of you guys is that it's really amazing how much knowledge and detail you have of the industry and of films and all the little things. And I learn a lot just from talking with each time we're together and we're discussing films. So thank you very much for being here today. So how this is going to work today is that basically each panelist is going to answer a question, or basically give a brief summary of their opinions and thoughts about the movie and why it is important for the movie to be considered in film history. Then next, we're going to take questions from the audience. We're going to try to take questions from the audience and as many as we can, but we may run out of time. We may have a lot of questions asked. But we're going to try to get a chance to get everybody to be heard. We're going to be here in an hour to 8:30, and so we'll see how many questions are being asked and how it goes. So a big thing to remember is that you can join in the discussion, basically go over to your side, I don't know what side it is, side or the bottom, I've heard, and type a question about the film in the comments area. I will be monitoring that and trying to see if I can pull anything up to view for questions. And just also, we have special people from around the country joining in with us. We have Ken and Cody, our booking agents from Bozeman, Montana, are joining to watch us. So Ken and Cody out there in Bozeman, thank you for joining us. This is our new experiment to do something beyond what we always traditional, what a traditional theater is all about. And this is our first attempt to look at going beyond what we've always known as a theater. So thank you very much and for being there. All right, so let's get going now and let's start out this session about Chinatown. Okay, I've got to go up to here now, sorry. Get rid of it. So anyways, join the discussion, type a question about the film when you get a chance. But let's start out with asking Kevin to ask a question about, answer the question. So, Kevin, why is this film, Chinatown, important in your mind to be considered in film history?
Well, I think it's when it was released in 1974, there was a lot of things that were changing in the Hollywood studio system. There was a sort of a turnover of what remained of the old guard that ran the studios. So it was becoming much younger. Filmmakers like Francis Coppola and Peter Fonda and William Friedkin and certainly Martin Scorsese were bringing a new independent streak to the Hollywood films that were released here in the United States. Roman Polanski came over from Europe and had made Rosemary's Baby in 1969, I believe was the year that came out. So it was right on the cusp of things changing. It was the last era of before blockbusters started dominating screens. Sort of that transition began a little bit with The Godfather and then went full on with Jaws in 1975. So Chinatown sits right at the edge between the remains of old Hollywood and the blockbuster era that we're still in today. And its perfection is very, very simple to see when you watch it. I hope everyone got a chance to watch it. But for me, that's why it has that great, great importance in the whole of film history.
Well, thank you, Kevin. And Ted, what is it, how do you feel about this film and why it should be in film history? What's important to you about it to be in film history?
Well, first I have to excuse myself. Our dogs wanted to join in and they don't speak very good English. So I had to put them aside. And I didn't hear what Kevin had to say. I guess the big thing for me was Roman Polanski. He's somebody that started off in the from Poland in the in the 60s, and he made some very odd films, theater of the absurd kind of films. And then he got into Hollywood, and he already had his tools of what he wanted, and he made so many films before. So when he came to Hollywood, he was ready to go ahead and make films on his own, the way he wanted to. So there's a great deal of good craftsmanship that comes from Roman Polanski's abilities as a director. And when you read about the history of this film, there was a script by Robert Towne, who was a sort of his baby. But it was too long and it was too complicated. And they got Roman Polanski to come along, and he edited it down so that it became a kind of movie that people would, the structure of it. And apparently that end shot is something that he just dreamed up. They really didn't know how to end the film. And then there's that great line of, it's just Chinatown. And then the drawing back with the screen there. So what you've got is old Hollywood techniques and forms, but at the same time, kind of the taboos that were allowed to come in the 70s. So there was this nice combination of old and the new. Somebody was saying, well, how come it's a film noir or a neo-noir? And you just have to see that they're Venetian blinds, because every noir film has Venetian blinds in it. So for me, it's the director choosing where the camera is and putting it all together and having a vision to pull this thing together so that it has a coherent whole to it. So that's basically what I have.
Well, thank you, everybody. That's pretty good. I'd say the same things on both sides. It's just a powerful movie. You can go back in time, and it doesn't mean go back in time. It's timeless. And it has all the elements of a very good story and a drama. It goes back to the Greeks. So it's very good. But we do have a question, a first question. And it relates, as you were talking about, is that it relates, this is from Larry Hauser. Nope, not that one. he's asking the question, did they live happily ever after? We had some questions come in before the session, and most of them were about the ending, because the ending is not a typical Hollywood ending, how it came to be, how did audiences react to it? And you touched on it a little bit, Ted, at the end there. How did this shot get done? How did it get done? And that's, to me, in my memory, that's the best, biggest memory of the movie is the ending. And how did it play a part in Chinatown only winning one Oscar? So what about that ending? And why didn't they live happily ever after? Or did they really? Who would like to start this, Kevin?
Yeah, let me take that one. It's very interesting. Did they live happily ever after? Because in Town's original script, the one that was alluded to, which was 6 hours, 7 hours long, Evelyn Mulray shoots Noah Cross dead. And Jake Gittes swoops in, grabs Catherine and Evelyn Mulray, and they ride off into the sunset. That was the first version. The second version has had Evelyn Mulray shooting Noah Cross dead, but not being able to explain why. And Gittes won't explain why either, and Evelyn goes to prison. That's the end. That would have been a wonderful ending during the production code where the guilty had to be punished. But Polanski wanted something far darker. And as Ted alluded to, they started shooting without an ending, and they really, until December 9th was the last script revision. And that's when they sort of filled in what the ending was gonna be a little bit. And Polanski wanted something dark. And as they were revising the script beforehand, he had actually told Town at one point, defending his wanting there to be this horrible ending with Evelyn Mulray being killed and Noah Cross going off with Catherine Mulray to continue that incestual relationship generationally, which is just horrifying. And Polanski told Town, blondes die in Los Angeles. Sharon did, alluding to Polanski's wife who had been killed 4 or 5 years earlier. by the Manson family. So Polanski had this dark view of what the ending should be. Now, the other piece of the ending that that also touches is, remember, this was made in 74. They were making it during the Watergate hearings and the Watergate. And there was this, you know, obviously a feeling of, you know, the authority and government and power could get away unchecked with anything. So they, Polanski layered that onto it as well, creating the ending that, yeah, is one of the most sort of shocking and disturbing endings. You can just see John Huston's hand, his huge hand, come across Catherine Mulray's eyes, covering it, and he wraps her into his bosom, and you just know the you know what's going to happen next. And it's I think it's one of the darkest endings of any film. It's brilliant, but it's also dark and horribly disturbing. So,
Ted, how do you feel about that?
Well, the only thing I'd add is that apparently Town had an idea of making a trilogy out of this based on other things that happened in L.A., scandals and that kind of thing. And actually, Jack Nicholson directed one called The Two Jakes a couple of years later. And I think it takes place after World War II. And yeah. I've seen it a long time ago. I guess I should have looked at it, reviewed it for us here, but it had something, I'm not sure it had to do with land values and all that kind of thing. It wasn't a very successful film, but it carried the same kind of mode to it. And I'm not sure what, I think the third one was supposed to be pretty much in the 50s or something like that, and that never got made. So while Town, the film, you know, the writer had this view, you know, this expansive view of L.A., this pageantry of history. Polanski took it and as was alluded to by Kevin, personalized it and showed, you know, something very horrible. And there's a lot of that in Polanski's films, even before this movie called Repulsion, where Catherine Deneuve goes crazy in her apartment and things like that. And I guess if you know Polanski's history from being in Poland, you know, his parents were in concentration camps and that kind of thing. So he's had an incredible life, that's for sure. But again, you know, what makes this movie great too is that here is this genre film and it's Hollywood, and then there's this personal part to it that he added to the movie. And I think it even has to do with when he takes the knife and slicks like Jack Nicholson's nose. That's pretty audacious kind of thing too. And that's another Polanski touch to this thing. Anyway, I can go on and on. But no, they didn't live happily ever after.
Well, let me ask you this, just to go on a little discussion. This was 1974. Was this also revealing? Was Polanski revealing himself in the movie as a director because he had such an influence on the script, on the rewriting of the scripts? Do you think that was himself really being with all this stuff going on and what we found out later about him? Do you think that's what was really happening here? Is that a possibility?
Yeah, I mean, he never wanted to come back to the United States. After Sharon Tate had been murdered, after hanging around L.A. for about 4 or 5 months after that, doing a self-investigation on the murders, he went to Europe and sort of vowed never to come back, never to make a movie. But during that time when he was mourning here, Robert Evans and Jack Nicholson were two of his closest allies and confidants and support system. So when the two of them asked him to come back, it was more, he thought that it would be more familial, that it would be in a family. And Polanski added the set designer, the costumer, and the assistant director were all people that had worked on Rosemary's Baby and again were friends of his. So everything he did to be successful with Chinatown was to surround himself with things that made him comfortable in Los Angeles. So I think that, yes, it definitely reeks of Roman Polanski's sense of Los Angeles as a dark, cynical and foreboding place. For him, it wasn't a happy place. So yeah, I think that's interwoven throughout the script that, you know, even Robert Towne said is more Polanski's than his. Ted alluded to that in his intro saying, you know, this is Polanski's film. Towne got the only Oscar, but this is definitely Roman Polanski through and through.
Well, very good. And looking at it, we got another question here from Louise. And Louise is asking, how much do you think John Huston's real life influenced his character in Chinatown?
Ted, you want that one?
You can have it.
Okay. Well, here's the thing about John Huston. I mean, he's the perfect person to play Noah Cross because of his physical presence. You know, he was bigger than life. He lived bigger than life. You know, at one point he even gave up his U.S. citizenship to live in Ireland on a manor house, which is where Angelica Huston and some of his other kids did most of their formative years. So yeah, I think his past brings something to Chinatown. Now he hadn't acted for, I'm trying to think of the last one, maybe 7-8 years. And never in a role as substantial as this since much earlier in his career. But I think his stature in Hollywood was such that there's that gravitas that when you see him sitting at that table, it's not surprising that he would serve someone a fish head to intimidate them. It's a very simple read, even for people who might not know John Huston. And actually Robert Towne, again, just quickly alluding to the finale, said that he has this simian look about him and those big hands, like the hands of a gorilla as they wrap Catherine Mulray up. So he has that gravitas and that, you know, he just brings it to the screen and he's very intimidating. You know, and if you want to get super creepy, you know, Jack Nicholson was dating John Huston's daughter, Angelica, at the time of this movie. So when John Huston asked, or when Noah Cross asked Jay Giddies, "Are you sleeping with my daughter?" There's multiple meanings to that question. And I'm sure Jack Nicholson was run through the ringer sitting around the Huston dinner table on more than one occasion. So yeah, I think it, everything, definitely his career. I mean, heck, they give John Huston credit for starting the film noir movement with The Maltese Falcon in 1942, his directorial debut. He helped put in place a bunch of the noir tenets that Polanski and Towne and everybody else utilized for forever and a day. So, yes, it's a great question because, Huston definitely looms over this in a big way. So good question.
Ted, any thoughts?
Can I just say, I don't think John Huston's very much of like a method actor. And I think he's, when he gets a role, he just really enjoys playing, being a ham and kind of playing it up.
Yeah.
And we were talking about incest and all that kind of thing. Apparently around this time, this is gossip, I'm going to say, but it plays to what it is going on in this movie. Around this time, apparently, Jack Nicholson learned for the first time that this woman he grew up with, which was that he thought was his sister, was really his mother. So I could use some language here, but it's a real mind. That must really twist your mind when you learn that kind of thing. So it was all this stuff going on at the same time when this movie was being made. Anyway.
Yeah. Yes.
Okay. All right. We've got another question then coming up from Susan Egan. This is about James Hong. He's can you tell us more about the career of James Hong? He played Evelyn's butler in Chinatown, but he's had a pretty long and illustrious career, I've read. Anybody want to tackle that one first?
I don't know anything about him.
Yeah, I don't know a ton about him, but I know that he pops up in some of the coolest movies that have been made. I mean, Chinatown was the first. Big Trouble in Little China was another. And then I think his part in Blade Runner is incredibly impactful. It's not a huge part, but it's a great part. So I know that the parts that he does play, I know he was on, he did an episode of Seinfeld, for instance. So, you know, he pops up in different places. He was also in The Two Jakes, reprising the same character that he played in Chinatown. But I don't know a lot about him as a, you know, more than just these cool movies that he pops up in. I know he's still alive, which is a good thing, of course. But that's pretty much as much as I know about James Hong. I like him, but I don't know a ton about him. So,
okay. All right. Well, thank you very much. We have another question. This time is from Rick Andrews. Rick Andrews is asking, hi, Rick, what specific elements were most breakthrough for this new generation film? What specific elements were a breakthrough for this film?
Ted, you want to take this one or you want me to take it?
You take it.
Okay.
I'll follow up maybe. Yeah.
The first thing is sort of the elephant in the room that comes out at the beginning of the third act, which is the ancestral relationship between Noah Cross and Catherine Mulray. That was the first time that I tried to find something else. The first time that a major studio had released a movie where incest was overtly a plot point in the film. There have been since many, but that was the first one. So I think that's probably the main thing, is that plot point had never really been exploited in a mainstream film. But more importantly, I think, and Ted talked about this in his intro, you look at this new kind of filmmaking that Polanski helped to usher in, to the United States. It was a European model that was, you know, sort of started by the French New Wave in the early 60s, which was all natural lighting, shoot on locations wherever you could, get in, get out of shots as quickly as possible, try and capture as much natural sound as you could. And it really sort of, and you look at what Martin Scorsese doing at the same time, Alice Doesn't Live Here Anymore, very similar type filmmaking. Easy Rider, for instance, was a great example of, you know, of that from 1969, of this type of filming that was evolving. And that's why I said there was this short window after the Hollywood system had died and before the blockbusters and the money men all took over Hollywood. There was this little window, this 6 or 7 year window where this European style filming was more prevalent. And I think that's the greatest impact. And you want to see how that sort of manifested itself in Chinatown. And I think I mentioned this in the introduction that we had that I taped last week, that the original cinematographer was old school Stanley Cortez, who had shot the Magnificent Ambersons in their 40s for Wells. And Polanski and Evans hated it, and they dumped him a week into shooting, and they brought in John Alonso, who had shot documentaries for Jacques Cousteau, had never really had important feature film work. But he could capture what Polanski wanted. He could do setups quickly. He could, if you look at, there's a scene when Evelyn and Gittes are driving to the old folks home, and they're driving down a road, and it's a long scene, but the light behind them is stunningly beautiful. And the shot is lit with one light on the hood of the car. And it was essentially a one take opportunity, because the sun behind them would set if they didn't get it in this one long take. And it's got to be 3 or 4 pages of dialogue while they're driving. And that's what John Alonso could do. He could get that in one shot and get this beautiful lighting that Polanski wanted. Polanski framed everything, but Alonso lit all the shots. And I think that type of filmmaking was new to the United States. And that's probably a longer answer than necessary, but I think it's that's to me, that's the hook. Is
I agree with that. Ted? Any more, Cal?
I would say another thing is, many of us love old Hollywood movies because there's all this stuff that's implied. You know, the incest and divorces and, you know, the fade out where they're going into a room and they're going to have sex. So, I mean, I really love the way these things are implied. And of course, there's always got to be a happy ending, and evil must be at least eliminated somehow, one way or another. And so by the 70s, things were a little more obvious. But I'd have to say the main thing was getting outside, and it really has the color and the light of L.A. And when you see the studio movies, it's all lamps and inside studios and all kind of things. And I think that's one of the huge changes of what was happening in the 70s. And it continued to this day when all that stuff is now computer generated. So that's for another story. That's for another day.
So that's so true that this film and that period of films really started that type of filming using the natural lights, the natural sounds. Last year, what was in the foreign film that was won the Academy Award for the best foreign film? It was on Netflix, right? Wasn't it, Kevin?
Roma.
Roma. So it was on Netflix and on Roma. And that was a director's film. And this Polanski's was a director film, just like we're going to see a Hitchcock film coming up. And Hitchcock is a director, and he made his films like a director's film, which means that they're more concerned about the lighting, the visual, and the sound they're hearing, not so much as the dialogue, and the story will come through. And that's my interpretation of this movie as well. They tried a lot to show all the pictures of it, everything. You got a lot just from the pictures without having to say. There's a lot of times where there's no words being said. Right. And you got a lot just from the pictures. So, okay. Well, thank you. We keep talking about this issue of Chinatown and the ending of it. And Elizabeth Egan has also asked us now, was it only Chinatown? That only thing, what's it about China, that final word in China? Don't worry about it. Forget about it, Jake. It's only Chinatown. Is that meant to be more than a dismissive statement? What's your interpretation of that statement, and how does that play into the whole thought of the movie?
Well, I don't know if it really has all that much meaning, except that, there's a tradition in Hollywood movies that China is seen as this mysterious, inscrutable kind of thing. And I think it has something to do with that this is something that you really can't put a label on because it's Chinatown, because that's where mystery things happen and unusual things happen. And that's the excuse of why something this horrible could happen. And it happened to be located in part of Chinatown, I guess in LA, but I don't know that much about LA, but that's my take on it at any rate. And sometimes you just got to have a nice tag. It sounds great to end the movie, you know, and it doesn't really have to have any great meaning, but it does sound great, you know.
Well, the first thing that Robert Towne had was the title, and he supposedly got it. He went to a Hungarian vice cop who was also breeding dogs, and he was buying his dog, his beloved dog, Hira, I think his name was. Who actually got credit for writing Greystoke, by the way, the dog did. He was buying him, and so he's asking the vice cop what he does. He said, I work in Chinatown. And the cop, he said, well, what do you do in Chinatown? And the cop said, as little as possible. And Towns said, you know, why is that? And he said, well, we can't penetrate the culture in Chinatown. There's these warring gangs, that have their own rules and their own their own beliefs, and we can't penetrate it. So to do nothing is better than to do something. So Towne took that to heart, and he made, and, you know, it echoes a little bit through the film when Noah Cross says, you have no idea what you think you know, but you don't know what you're talking about. And Gittes says, that's what the DA used to tell me about Chinatown. So, you know, it sort of echoes through a little bit. But Robert Towne says that what Chinatown, while it is a state of mind, it also represents Los Angeles as a whole. Because Los Angeles has this sort of this duality of a place of dreams but then it's also this hugely exploitive and capitalistic place. So it's all glitz and glory, but it's also this place of dreams. So it's the yin and yang of capitalism is manifested 100% in Los Angeles. So it's all unknowing, according to Townsend. So yes, there's a specific place of Chinatown, which is why he never wanted anything set in, actually in, no scenes to take place in Chinatown. It was purely a state of mind, but it also reflected Los Angeles as a whole. So there's a lot of, so I don't think it's a dismissive statement yet. Yeah, it's one of the, probably the best two or three final lines in any movie, but it's not, I don't think it's dismissive at all. I think it's like, this is it, man. This is Chinatown. This is LA. This is America right now. We have a potentially a criminal in the White House, and we have corporate greed running amok, and here you go, people, enjoy your film. And that's Chinatown.
Ted,
there's a documentary called LA As It Plays, and it's about 3 hours long. It's very long, but it goes through all the different movies and that took place in LA. If you ever get a chance to see it, it's pretty fascinating.
I'm just going to wrap up. This is a good question because some comments that came in from other people beforehand. There was discussion among us because I know this is an interpretation too. Is if you compare this movie to like the book or the movie Great Gatsby or other things, there's always a part where the wealthy go to play and have fun and get away with doing whatever they want to. That mysterious place like Ted talked about. And you can get away with anything, including murder and all these other things, like in the Great Gatsby, all the stuff going on. And so when it's dismissive into the point that it's don't worry about it, it's only Chinatown, because it is this mysterious place, and we can come in here and do what we want to do. So it's all these, when you have that mystery place and it's well-defined, we know that there's a lot of things going on that probably shouldn't be going on, and we're just not going to talk about them. And that's what everybody in the whole movie kept trying to tell him. Don't worry about it, Jake. Don't worry about it.
What's the first words that Escobar says after Evelyn Mulray's been shot through the eye? Cut them all loose. So everybody in cuffs is being cut loose. Everyone's walking away. They're sweeping this under the rug because it's Chinatown. So yeah, anything goes is the easy, the simple moniker.
Yep. So we have enough. So this will go on to the next question here. This is from Dave Kozlowski. Sorry, I'm not really good at this. Sorry. Are there any positive parts of LA shown in the film, or is it all dark?
Oh, it's lots of sunshine.
Yeah.
No clouds in the sky.
No clouds right. in the sky. I've lived out in the LA area in that California, and I was amazed that the weather was like, that'd be on for like 30 seconds. So what's the forecast? Well, we have sunny today, sunny tomorrow, sunny the next day. Back to you, bud. Right.
I guess my question would be, is it all dark? That's metaphorically speaking in this film, yes. Any place you go, there's darkness. If you're at Noah Cross's house, there's darkness. If you're at Catherine Mulray's house, there's darkness. Obviously there's murder there as well. In Jake's office, there's darkness, right? Anywhere. I mean, the first shot of the whole film is two people having sex outdoors in a public place, and to not be too specific, but they're doing it in a way that animals do it. So as they say, so it's, yes, there's darkness, in that way, but then it's countered by the fact that most of this film takes place during the day. The last scene certainly takes place at night in darkness, but most of the other scenes are during the day. You look at the scene at Noah Cross's house, the first one where that character's introduced. Certainly the opening scene where Jake is introduced and where Evelyn Mulray is introduced as well. It takes place during the day, which is sort of counter to that, to the idea of LA's darkness. But then what takes place behind these closed doors is incredibly dark. So I don't know if it'd be used as a calling card by the LA Chamber of Commerce, but you know, there's certainly some beautiful architecture captured in the film. I'll give them that. So there's a little lightness there. But yeah, there's darkness for sure.
Ted, anything else besides the, if you see any of this graphic, it's three pieces of Chinatown.
The fact that historically, LA exists because of this water thing that happened. I mean, that's really, there was a scandal, and I guess it was Mulholland, what's his name, Mulholland, or whoever his name was, actually did pull this trick of getting, draining the valleys in up farther north in California. So the whole basis of LA's existence was based on a fraud. And that's brought up in the very beginning of the movie, where the sheep come into the hearing at the city hall, wherever it is. But anyway, that's part of the darkness too, is that LA could not exist if it weren't taking the water away from the other parts of the state. And that was all done very underhandedly. And yeah, the other thing is, and this is an LA confidential, is that the cops were really awful throughout the 30s and 40s and 50s and 60s in LA. And that's kind of referenced somewhat in this film too. So there was all kinds of, but what was seeing on television was Dragnet. And good old Joe Friday, who was always doing the good job, but that the real story was that Incredibles, the police were just awful. And well, enough of that.
All right. Let's see here. We got another question in from Louise Benzer. Louise is asking, what is your opinion of your Robert Towne's second best script? And should he be really considered a great screener, or is this really Polanski's baby? I mean, this is still Polanski's got his fingers in everything here. And I know that in your intro, you talked about how Polanski really got involved with that, and they had him and Robert Towne hashed it out before they went into production.
Yeah. So while he got his second Oscar nomination for Greystoke, The Legend of Tarzan, it's really no contest what his second best screenplay is. It's The Last Detail that he made with Nicholson and Bob Rafelson 2 years, I think 72, 73, somewhere in there. That's a great script too. But after Chinatown, you know, you get Personal Best and
Shampoo's
not bad. Yeah, that was right after Chinatown. That's a good one. What else? Tequila Sunrise. Yeah. Ted, I don't know. I don't think there's anything close to The Last Detail as far as the second best.
So what about these other great? This is Robert Evans track record. Sorry, I'm pulling up the wrong graphic. I thought this was a Robert Towns. I saw Robert. Sorry, it's my problem. All right. Let's get rid of that. So I knew I'd do some like
these better. These are great songs, by the way.
So
but always in Hollywood, scripts go through many different phases, and oftentimes that's to the best, but other times things just get, people's great ideas are scuttled because of the necessities of making a buck.
Correct. Yes.
It's the bottom line in Hollywood always.
Yeah. Well, again, I mean, I keep referring back to this small window, and there are exceptions today. I don't want to discount everything that's been released since 1975. But, you know, in the studio era, you had, you know, writing by committee, where dozens of writers could touch any screenplay. And generally, the producer decided who got credit for it. And you know, sometimes it worked for the better, sometimes it worked for the worse. But then, you know, you have the auteurists, you know, Billy Wilder, Preston Sturges, who never let anybody touch their scripts. But most of them, yeah, scripts are a collaborative process. And Towne certainly benefited from Polanski's collaboration. Towne even said that Polanski was his best collaborator. So many years later, he gave Polanski credit for the screenplay.
I don't know if we're running out of time here, but that slide came up with Robert Evans, and I think a huge part of the success of this movie is Robert Evans, because he, in a lot of his films, he just let the directors do what they wanted to do.
Right.
And he trusted them to put out a good product. And that in his heyday, before he went berserk, that produced some really great films. But it was his keeping his hands off of it and letting these people do what they knew how to do best. So I think that's a huge reason this was a successful film. And these other films that are up here, I don't know about The Love Story, but I meant something to him personally, well, I know. With but anyway, The Godfather and all these others, really, he deserves a lot of credit for being the kind of producer a director would want. And I'll say another thing. Somebody like Polanski and these filmmakers, once they get a chance to make a film, they're going to put everything they've got into it, because there's so little opportunity to do these things. And that's one thing I think is great about Chinatown, is that everybody gave it their best and there weren't any real compromises. And it's very rare that you see that kind of thing that happens in a Hollywood film. You know, everyone, that's the set design, the film editor, everything was just clicking along. And they had great acting too, and great script. And when that happens, there's nothing better than the Hollywood movie, when all those components come together.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah, I would agree with you on Robert Evans in his producing thing. Although I think Francis Coppola would not agree with that. He drove me crazy on The Godfather, but I think you're right with the type of producer that he was, to let the directors get loose and do what they wanted to do is right in his wheelhouse. Yeah, and then sadly Robert Evans just died almost a year ago. Right now, I think it was April of 19 that he died. So
yeah, we tried the grand old man of Hollywood.
Yeah. Yes.
Yes. All right. So we got another really good question for you guys. This one is really good. This is from Lucy Simone, and is, what is the significance of the little boy on the horse? So I probably all have opinions of this. Ted, you go first.
I don't have any opinion on that.
Okay, here's my thumbnail, and this is not based on any research that I've done or anything, but Escobar mentions at one point, and I think Hollis Mulholland mentions too, that there was a dam that broke, and he doesn't want to repeat that by building this new reservoir with a dam. Well, that was based on a real story where 500 Mexican migrant workers were killed when the dam did burst outside of Los Angeles in part of their water system in the early part of the century. So I think that boy, who's obviously of Hispanic origin, as he's riding through that empty riverbed, it's sort of cast back to that horrific accident that happened. And there was an extra scene in the movie that didn't get filmed where Escobar actually blames Hollis Mulray for the death of all these migrant workers. And there's this, you can see the disdain when they pull Mulholland, when they pull Mulray's body out of the reservoir. Escobar doesn't seem too broken up about it. And that's because there's a missing scene where he actually goes in and talks about the 500 Mexicans that were killed. So I think that this is just my supposition, but that's what it's meant to signify, is this horrible tragedy. And there's this boy who's left, who by himself rides through this empty riverbed. It's also a great plot point, right? You get a little bit of information, but that's the genius of the script, is stuff like that exists. So that's what I think he means. I'm just, yeah.
I think it's got a lot of significance. And again, I've been living out in LA, and every year it only rains in that area from like December to March. And thinking, look, that's what it is. And when the rains come, those riverbeds get flooded out. And every year there are people who die who are living in those ravines, and unexpectedly. And something like that could happen. So that kind of leads into another question here from Tom Skinner. Is there any similarity between the film and real events in the fight to get water to LA and the valley? Anything you know about?
Yes. Okay. So if you look at it this way, Hollis Mulray equals William Mulholland. Mulholland was the idealist, but he's often been painted as the bad guy. But there was these guys who he worked with, Tom Egan, and there's some guy named like Periwinkle or something like that. They were the land speculators. Mulholland was the idealist who just wanted to bring water. And yes, they went 230 miles away to the, I think it's the Owens Valley, to get the from the Eastern Sierras, where they get the water, and it's fed 230 miles via aqueduct, purely on gravity. It's gravity fed. And up till about 10 years ago, it was supplying about 80% of the water to Los Angeles. So there was this speculation land grab that these capitalists did. It went on for about 20 years. So it started in 1903 when they started building the aqueduct until the late 20s. This takes place in 37 and the film does. And Town just said he had to compress all that into a short period of time for the film's reason. But it was really this speculation, this exploitation of the Owens Valley that LA did. They annexed 2 years after they built the aqueduct, they annexed the San Fernando Valley so that they could, because that's where these people had built all their, or had bought all this property on speculation. They annexed it into the city of Los Angeles so that they could then utilize the water that they had now brought to it. But Mulholland gets a bad rap. I'm sure he wasn't an innocent, but he at least had a more civic-minded hope for the water than did. So Mulray would be Mulholland, and Noah Cross would be Egan, and a bunch of those other ne'er-do-wells.
And I also see this like in Citizen Kane, how it was out the Hearst Empire, you know, the movie was kind of portraying Hearst Empire. So that
that's what Polanski wanted with all those pictures of Noah Cross in Mulray's office and that anti office that Jake keeps getting stuck in. And there's all those pictures. He wanted Noah Cross to be a Hearstian type character before you ever met him. So you see him standing in those, you know, in those big pipes, and he's, you know, he's looking rather majestic with his cane and very authoritarian. And, you know, that was deliberate. Polanski wanted that before you even meet the guy, you're already intimidated by him. So,
okay. Well, good. We're getting low on time here, but we still got time for some more questions here. This is, and we have a big announcement at towards the end of the film. So we're gonna make sure we stop at a certain point to tell everybody. So stick around for another few minutes. And yes, we know this, we're a nonprofit, and if you have a chance to donate to us, please do. But we're all volunteers here, and we're hoping you're having a good evening at home doing this. Let's take a next list. This one's from Steve Bester. Why does Claude call Jake Kitty Cat? Just to play on his name or something deeper or what?
Well, okay, so yeah, Claude's only in a couple scenes, only one scene of merit, which is when Roman Polanski, who plays Claude, cuts Jake's nose. And a couple days before that, Jack Nicholson wanted to cut filming short because he wanted to watch a Los Angeles Lakers and Boston Celtics basketball game, and Polanski was insisting on getting one more shot. They got into a screaming match. Polanski went after the television in Nicholson's trailer, tried to destroy it. He couldn't. Nicholson tore off all his clothes in disgust, and they both stormed off the set and left. Then flash forward to 3 days later when they're going to shoot the knife to the nose scene, and Polanski designed the knife himself, which was a nine-inch switchblade that had a hinged top. So the top of the blade was hinged, but it only hinged one way. So Nicholson was very leery of this because obviously this is his career. If he really gets his nose cut, if Polanski has it upside down, he gets his nose sliced. So leading up to that, and to answer the question, Polanski improvised that because he was trying to put Nicholson on edge about the knife. Because you know that obviously would incite fear, and you know they're both method guys, so there's the fear. Well, they got the take, and then there was a like a blood tube on the one side of it. So then when he flicked it, he sprayed the blood, he got it. They got the shot on the first take, but Polanski insisted on 14 more takes to torment Nicholson for wanting to watch the basketball game. And each time Nicholson would say, "Let me see the knife, you got it the right way." And Polanski would laugh and hold it up to him. And then they'd do the flicks and the spray of the blood 14 times to do that. So Kitty Cat was just a mere prelude to the shenanigans that Polanski was pulling on Nicholson while they shot that scene.
Okay, well, that's good. We got time for one last question here. And this one is from Ted Kroll, but Ted Sarnecki. Ted Sarnecki, sorry about that. And I think some of the, this is another question. Where is it? This is the thing, yours must have been based on the idea. Where did I find the question you had? This is it. Sorry, I was scrolling through the comments. I was on the run. Can you talk? Some people were talking about it online. I like this. People are commenting. It's very good. I get distracted a little bit. Can you talk about the two Jakes, the Chinatown sequel? It was generally panned. Mm-hmm. Can you share about the
two? Okay, so Ted Kroll, you said you didn't watch it again for this. I made the mistake of watching it. So I did watch it the other day.
All I know is Town really had an idea for a trilogy.
Yeah,
there was a lot of effort to try to put this movie together, the two Jakes.
Yeah,
and that apparently, if I remember correctly, was about the land speculation
and that kind of thing. Yeah, the second one was
selling plots and all that kind of thing.
Yeah, the first one was about water.
I'm sorry.
No, so yeah, the first one was about water. The second one was about land, because it was totally about land speculation in the valley.
And Nicholson took it on as a personal project. It has the same look as Chinatown. And again, I don't think it was that bad. I thought it was pretty interesting.
I guess it just wasn't
in the right time of people being interested in it. So it just didn't click with the time of when the film was made.
Yeah,
I don't know what ever happened to the third one part of the trilogy.
The three of them, so Evans, Town, and Nicholson, formed a company to make it in like 1984. And Evans was supposed to play the other lead. Robert Evans, the producer, was going to play the other lead. And then Town was going to write and direct. So Town wrote, they did some screen tests with Evans. He was a horrible actor who could not, hold a candle to Nicholson, obviously. So they.
What a pretty boy.
Yeah. So by this time he wasn't that pretty because he'd been doing cocaine for about 15 years. So he wasn't really, he was paying the price. So Nicholson in Town went to him and said, "Bob, you can't be in it." So that set him back about 4 or 5 years. And when they went to shoot it with Nicholson starring and Town writing and directing, Town essentially was on the verge of a nervous breakdown. He had, gone through personal best, Greystoke, all these horrible things that happened to him, and his career was in the tank. So he panicked, and 2 days before they were going to start shooting, and couldn't direct it. He's like, "I can't do it." So Nicholson stepped in at the last moment, and I think the plot is very convoluted. There's some wonderful moments, but it's a Town script unchecked is how I would do it. It just loses.
He did Polanski.
Yes, exactly. It just lost cohesion. But one of the things I liked that Nicholson did is, and this goes back to Chinatown, is if you watch Chinatown, Polanski shot most everything over Nicholson's shoulder, which was very unusual. But he did that because he kept a singular point of view throughout Chinatown, which is not easy to do because it allowed Polanski's genius in the script of Chinatown is we never break from Jake's point of view. And we only know as much as Jake knows. And we see clues like the glasses in the title pool that he doesn't pick up the first time. We see those clues and we wonder just as Jake does, but then we're distracted because that's when Evelyn walks in.
Okay. So I got to break in here because we're getting down to our time.
Oh, sorry. I could talk forever.
we're getting a lot of good comments, and Ted came back and said, I hope this will become a regular event. And Ted, I want everybody to know, we've already got a couple of months, about a month worth of programming for this. We'll be back next week, same time, same station. Let me see if we can get this up here with North by Northwest. Ted has already put together a intro for it. It's out on our YouTube channel. You can watch it. It'll be out in everything publicized in our email on Friday, as well as on our website and some Facebook posts too. So you get a chance to start watching North by Northwest. If you haven't seen it before, go do it, especially if you're younger. Go see some of these classics and you want to sit around and watch these movies. Just find some really good ones. We're going to try to help you to do that. So North by Northwest.
Yeah, we want to hear what next Thursday.
What? Next Thursday.
We really want to hear what you want to see.
Yes.
About what you want to
see. Film you see. So please, you can go through and we'd like to know what kind of stuff you want to see. So when you do there, constructive feedback, give us back to us at Beyond at Bay Community Theater. But also to if you have any ideas for suggested films, future films you want to see, or if you want to help us out in any ways. We're looking to, this is just the start, and we'd like to continue on with this. And what I'm seeing today is a very good response from everybody in participation, and we appreciate it very much. So farewell, everybody. Have a good night and look at. Thank you, Ted. And thank you very much, Kevin. And we want to thank you very much. And as we end out, we'll end with the theme song to North by Northwest. Have a good one, guys. Thank you very much for coming to this and all the audience. This was awesome.
Thank you, Larry.
Thank you.
Yeah. No, I'm freezing, but I talk too much.
I'm
ending the broadcast.